There are multiple reports that Jaguar is going to be delaying some of the deliveries for the current iPace reservation holders. Reminds you of someone? We're going to talk about it and a few other things coming up next. Welcome to those of you who are watching me on Patreon, and of course, if this is your first time here and you're watching me on YouTube and you want to stay up to date on everything that's going on in the world of electric cars, go ahead and click on that subscribe button down there so you don't miss anything moving forward. All right, so as you know, Jaguar I-PACE production has pretty much started, and they've been taking reservations for a while now, and there are reports now, I've seen some postings on the few forums, and there's also a report, I think Electric had the article about it today, that they're also getting some reports that, you know, these deliveries are being pushed by, you know, a couple of months. Now, obviously, it's not surprising for any of those of us who ever waited for to get our Teslas, but this is obviously new for people trying to get themselves their very first iPace. And there are a couple lessons to learn here. First of all, making electric cars is hard. Making, you know, one of the first electric cars in the world is hard, and there will be delays. Now, I kind of thought that maybe a Jaguar would be able to kind of learn their lesson and learn their lessons on what Tesla had gone through, right? They're saying right now that the reason for that this delivery is going to be delayed is because they're trying to prioritize. But that's something that they didn't have to wait until people place their order to understand where priorities are. Now, Tesla, for example, was pretty clear about at least geographical locations of those deliveries and the priorities for those deliveries. Jaguar didn't really... they didn't seem to learn a lesson here. And, you know, in the beginning, I was really high on Jaguar. I really, really liked the car, and I really was actually thinking I'm going to be getting one myself. I have to admit that after seeing some interior shots and everything and some reviews, I'm not as hot on it anymore. I think I'm going to be checking out the Audi e-tron first before I make that decision. But yeah, I mean, I really hope they figure this out. You know, Jaguar is not a high production high volume production car. I think they make about, you know, 100,000 a year. They're predicting about 20,000-25,000 for iPace. But, and don't forget, there's a humongous 20,000 car order from Waymo for them to deal with. So I wonder if the regular customers are going to be bummed for Google's order. Now, that would not be good, and I hope they manage that well, because they, you know, there can be a backlash. But nevertheless, this is something that we're going to have to deal with, I think, not just with Tesla and Jaguar. I'm pretty sure all other companies, the Porsches and Audis of the world, will probably have the same problem. I mean, this is the first time they're making a serious all-electric SUV, and there's a demand, and there's a magnifying glass on the production process and so forth. So we'll see. But, you know, I think it's a little bit, it's nice to know that it's not just Tesla's thing, right? It's just other manufacturers are going to be having the same problem. All right, let's move on to the next story. Of course, before that, just want to remind you that this channel and this video is sponsored by Evonex, the aftermarket accessories for Tesla. There's a discount code in the description of this video, so you guys can save yourselves a few bucks when you shop there. All right, here's a tweet that got some attention over the last few days. This one, Elon Musk was replying, talking about the delivery times, because that seems to be a pretty big bottleneck, you know, to deliver all this Model 3s and other cars that they haven't never seen the volume of them before, you know, because you gotta do the paperwork, you gotta, you know, explain the car and so forth. They wanted to get it down to only 5 minutes, by doing the paperwork online and getting most of the sort of, you know, training out by producing videos on how to get started online on their YouTube channel and their website. And I kind of thought it was working, but I guess it's not. You know, Elon had to come out and say, we're trying to get rid of contracts completely. Should just be the tap here and you get your car. Then if you don't like it for any reason, just return it like any other product. Okay, so I think this is a little bit of a dangerous territory. First of all, that's a very blunt statement. What do you mean if you don't like it, return by any reason? You got to put a time limit. You don't like it within the first 7 days, 30 days, first year, and you turn it for full price, partial price, market price, you know, so that's already very weird that he said that, because it can probably get him in some trouble when people can maybe even go to court over this, because it's so vague and yet, you know, return for any reason, any time kind of a thing. But let's go concentrate on the first part. It says tap here and you get your car. Well, no, let's concentrate first of all, no contracts. Obviously, you cannot get rid of contracts. Every, you know, I just bought my Volt a few days ago, and the process has been exactly the same that it's been for the last 25 years. When I was buying my Teslas, most of it was done online, right? In their electronic signatures now, faxes, emails, attachments, PDF files, and so forth. So you can do all of it pretty much online. You don't have to do it at the, you know, showroom floor or at the service center or whatever delivery center. But after that, once you get your car, really, and if you watch some of the, you know, you can put people in little mini movie theaters where you show them the videos like they do at the, I don't know, aquarium and zoos and stuff like that, right? People just sit there and watch videos, and then they go to their cars and just pick them up. So I thought the process was already figured out. Apparently not. And I'm not really quite sure what this means. Let me know if in the comment section if you guys have a different take on this. But it is a very odd tweet, though. I understand the intention is good, and I hope they do figure this out. All right, let's talk about the Volt, which, by the way, not this particular one. This one's mine. Okay, you can't have that one. But let's talk about Chevy Volt in general, because let's see, the Chevy Volt, there are a few surveys that they do every year, which car is like most American-made car. Now, you know, I know a lot of people watch this, you know, show in Canada and outside of the United States, but this is important because don't forget there are a couple of things that we have in play here that will affect companies like Chevrolet and Tesla, and therefore, you know, this car sales, electric car movement around the world, because don't forget, first of all, we're in this tariff war with everybody right now, right? Our president is just going crazy. It costing, you know, manufacturing some money. I think GM stocks suffer from it. You know, Tesla prices have soared in China, so that's going to hurt their sales. So because of that, you know, when these cars that are making electric cars are as American as they get, that's important for this. Maybe Trump will look, you know, our way here, and therefore the Tesla and Chevy benefit, and therefore the entire community will benefit, right? We won these two manufacturers, you know, that are upfront usually on car sales here, plus Nissan, to do well. And secondly, don't forget the tax credit, right, where there's a bill, and I've interviewed the congressman, you can see that interview on my channel, who proposed that bill in our House of Representatives and our Congress to extend, really, to remove the 200,000 car sales cap for the $7,500 tax rebate here in the United States. Again, we don't want the sales to tank, and therefore that's kind of important that these manufacturers are making cars that are mainly made here in the United States. Now, Chevy Volt, cars.com had their survey, and Chevy Volt came in at number 5 overall, which means it is number 1 plug-in electric vehicle, number 1 for the most made in America. Tesla did not make the top 10, but there was another one that came out from the Kogod index, and this one had both of them in the top 10. So Chevy was actually number 2, and I think the percentage of their parts made was about 66%. And then Tesla came in, I think, number 8. And, you know, the least number of parts, you know, is for Model 3 at the 45%. The most is for Model S at 55%, which is still kind of surprising. I didn't realize that there are so many parts are coming from outside. But obviously the batteries, right? That's Panasonic-made batteries. So once again, I thought there were mainly manufacturers here. So I was wrong there. I'm actually surprised. And Chevy Volt is just number 1 electric or plug-in electric car in the United States that's most American made. So that's interesting. Interesting. Not sure if it's good news, but it's definitely interesting. All right, let me remind you guys that this Saturday I have a follow-up to pretty much my most popular video on the channel. I'm going to have another interview with the owner of this house, one of the very first ones to get the Tesla solar roof. We're going to talk about some numbers, as you guys wanted to know a lot of these numbers. We're going to talk about that. Of course, I want to give some shout-outs to my new Patreons. Gene here just became a Patreon. Thank you so much. And so did Carlin, Garland. Thank you guys for becoming Patreons. And as a matter of fact, that also reminds me that I'm starting kind of a new segment that I've been kind of already doing for a little bit. It's going to be called The Extra Mile. This is where, you know, once I get off the air here for regular viewers, those who are watching me on Patreon and contribute to the show is going to get sort of a, you know, a bonus material and some extra commentaries and insights and so forth. probably right now in the next few days, it's going to be all about my move to Sacramento. So stay tuned for that. But first, let's go to the comment of the day. And this one is about the story that we talked about a lot. There were a lot of comments in the comment section about this guy, Montana Skeptic, that was, you know, pretty much electric car Tesla troll, really. He was exposed. His name was exposed. And there were, and it looks like Elon Musk even called his boss because he works for an investment firm, from what I understand. And he was also linked to some oil investments as well. Well, here's one of comments that this is, you know, a few people made similar comments. So let me read it out and address it right away. John Gilbert says, the fossil fuel investments are a red herring. Oil companies as good as investments does not require Tesla to be a bad one. They can be both. They can both succeed or fail. It's a red herring, part of an hominem. I don't even know what that word means. Distraction. You would have thought I would have looked it up, right? Before reading it on the air. No. It is irrelevant. Okay, so a few things. First of all, and a lot of people are saying, well, don't call him a troll just because he's a critic, he's not a troll. No, he's definitely a troll because, yeah, he's criticized Tesla a lot, and that's fine. Well, no, actually, that's not fine. When you criticize one company all the time, never give them kudos, or the other way around, just like I call out the Tesla fanboys who think that Tesla and Elon Musk is just perfect in every single way all the time, then you are not being objective, right? There's no such thing as a perfect company or a perfect person or whatever. So if you're going to be objectively reporting on something, there will be some good things, there will be some bad things. Yeah, some people lean one way or another, and that's fine. But if you're always saying Tesla sucks, Tesla's going to go bankrupt, with, by the way, very little evidence at this point, really, then yeah, you're not being objective at all. And then if you go into other people's accounts, and especially the pro-Tesla accounts, and you just literally troll them, right, just for the sake of trolling them, well, you're a troll, right? You, if you seek them out, if you see, oh, and by the way, and you do it all anonymously, gee, that really, I mean, that's pretty much the definition of a troll. So don't tell me he is a fair critic. He is a troll. He can also be a critic, not very fair, but, you know, he can be both. So first of all, that's. Now, yes, I understand that investment in oil companies can be just as good as bad as investment in the Tesla. But the thing is, he does have links to investment into the oil companies, but he doesn't have any link to investing into Tesla. As a matter of fact, he's betting against Tesla, right? He's shorting Tesla. He's trying to short Tesla. So he's kind of a doubling down on his oil industry investments. So he's investing into oil companies, hoping they're going to go up, obviously. At least he's linked to some of them. And then he is betting against Tesla, hoping, really hoping that they're going to lose. And as a matter of fact, how can it be really that fair in reporting if you have a personal agenda, which is money, right? So he's not like investing here, investing there and see which one works. He's heavily favoring the oil industry, and his favor, you know, consistently and aggressively has gone against Tesla. And, you know, some of you just got upset with my question. That wasn't even a statement, it was a question, like, should he be prosecuted? Now, I don't know the law, but to me, it seems wrong if you have personal interest in, you know, to make money, and you go out and you try to change perspective of the public on something just so you can benefit, especially if it includes a lot of lying and not true statements. To me, that kind of should be illegal. And I don't know if it is, maybe it's useless, but I think it's a good question for me to ask the audience. So some of you got upset over it. I'm sorry, you're just going to have to get over it. That just sounds wrong to me. I just don't know if it's illegal. So there you go. Just wanted to kind of address that. And let me know if you have any comments, you know, follow, you know, I'll be more than happy to hear your opinions again. As you know, I think I feature just as many negative or disagreements with me as I have agreements. As a matter of fact, that's kind of the most fun part, right? Agreeing is not, there's not much I can tell you when we agree, right? All right, so of course, let me remind you that just in a couple of minutes, we're going to do the extra mile for my Patreons. Going to talk about that live for those of, and by the way, if you want to become a Patreon, it's very simple. Go to patreon.com/e4electric. And thank you so much for contributing to the show. Other than that, I will see you guys tomorrow. And remember to stay charged.